Hi, I'm Jim Logan, and I had the privilege of writing this book last year, the book Reclaiming Surrendered Ground. And people have asked, what are the procedures, or how do the procedures that you use in counseling sessions with people during the week, how do they line up with the book? And that's a good question, because the book was written to be more of a logical presentation. But in counseling, we don't start where we start in chapter one. So I would like to share with you things that I've learned and things that could help you to take the truths of this book and to use this book in the lives of other people and helping them to come to freedom. The very first step in helping someone to come to freedom is to determine, is there genuine repentance? It's very important. In fact, this study of repentance is so important that I went to the Bible and I marked every passage that either demonstrated repentance or where the word repentance was found. And I think it's summed up in the book of Acts, where it says, faith is towards the Lord Jesus Christ, but repentance is towards God. We have in the prodigal son, where the boy came to the end of himself, and he said, I've sinned against heaven and against my earthly father. And so without repentance, we have found that we do not bring permanent help to a person. And so when someone calls and wants an appointment, the first thing that I try to find out from them or to information is to get, number one, why do they think that there's enemy involvement in their life? And I want them to share that with me, because we have so many people that come for counseling, it's impossible for us to see everyone that calls. We book sometimes 5 months ahead of time. So we want to be sure that the person is absolutely positive there's enemy involvement. I've found over the years, in trying to convince someone there's enemy involvement in their life, if they're not sure, it can take half your counseling time, and it's really not worth it. The second thing is, are they calling because they are sorry over the consequences of their sin? Or do they have a real desire to change and to be biblical and to walk with God? Is there genuine repentance? Many young people have been brought to here to counseling. Teenagers have been brought here that were not repentant. The folks wanted me to do something magical over them. The kids did not want to deal with the music issue. They maybe did not want to deal with the moral issues in their life. And it was basically a waste of time. And so I know that some of you watching this will be pastors, and you don't have near the freedom that I do in being able to say to a person, I don't think that you're ready for help yet. I know that can I've been a pastor, and I know that can cause a problem. But one of the things that a pastor can do is if you will give the person that wants help some project to do, either read a certain psalm or memorize a scripture or just anything, if the person is really sincere, then you know that they will do it. And you can say, well, our next counseling appointment is based on you reading this portion of scripture or memorizing this verse. And when you get that done, call me and we'll set that appointment. Now, as I said, the book was written logically to present the idea that the spirit world's real and so on. But as I've said, the people that come here are already aware the spirit world is real. What must we do? What do we try to accomplish in the first counseling session? And I'd like to share that with you, because that is the key session that sets the whole week. I see someone for 5 days, 3 hours a day. I find that we can get more accomplished in a person's life in a block time than over spreading it out over a long period of time. And also that the person when they're flying in, doesn't want to be here forever. That 1 week is sufficient, and I've been able to see over 1,000 people come through the counseling here, and to see them walk away from here, change people, and it's very exciting. One of the very first things that we want to do is to indicate to this person that not everything that pops into their mind is necessarily from them. Often, this is a very real enlightening experience for them. Because if you try to go into detailed counseling with someone who doesn't realize that all of these intruding thoughts in their mind are not from them, often they trip off in their mind, they're not with you, they can't hear what you're saying, or they're having thoughts, you're just a loser, you'll never win, you'll never get victory over this. All of these kinds of things can go on. And so we realize that this is a vital place to start. And I start in Matthew 16. And I start with a story about Jesus asking the disciples, who do men say that I am? And they give different ideas about that. And then Peter said, you art the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus said, Peter, you didn't figure that out, but God put that thought in your mind. Later on in this chapter, in 22 and 23, when Jesus talked about his crucifixion, Peter then said, Lord, don't go to the cross. And the Lord said, Peter, get behind me, Satan, for you do not understand the things that be of God, but of men. And that thought that came to Peter was of Satan. So I asked my counselees, do you think Peter was aware, first of all, that God put those thoughts in his mind when we do that section? They go, no. I said, all he did, Jesus asked a question, and Peter gave an answer, and he had no idea that God had put that upon his heart. And then when I asked them after they read this section, do you think Peter realized that this is what Satan wanted him to say? And they say, no. I don't think Peter had any idea that Satan put those thoughts in his mind. And then we go to 2 Chronicles 21:1. Where it said that when that Satan put in the heart of David to number the children of Israel. And they say, well, I don't think David would have known that. I said, I believe if David would have known that was the enemy, he never, never would have done that. And then we go to the Gospel of John, and we see where the scripture says that Satan put in the heart of Judas to betray Christ. You have Job chapter 2. Where Job's wife said, curse God and die. And I asked, where do you suppose that thought came from? And they said, well, that came from the enemy. I said, do you think Mrs. Job knew that she was speaking for the enemy? And they go, no. But she was trying to get Job to do what Satan wanted him to do. But the crowning one is Acts 5. That's Ananias and Sapphira. And Peter has discernment here. And as they are, he brings out to them, do you realize that those thoughts, he says, why did you allow Satan to fill your heart to lie against the Holy Spirit? I don't believe Ananias and Sapphira realized that those thoughts that came into the mind are from the enemy. I'd like to just read Acts 5, because in working with someone, this is a real tremendous verse. It's verse 4. Peter says, while it remained, was it not your own? He's talking about the property they had. And after it sold, was it not in thy own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And what I try to share with them there is this, and that is that none of these people were judged because Satan put thoughts in their mind. They were judged because those thoughts were conceived, and those thoughts gave birth to actions. And the one who was motivating them to do that was the enemy. And then I take them briefly to 2 Corinthians 10:3-5, where it says that we are not fighting flesh and blood. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but we are to take our thoughts captive. If we allow our thoughts to control us, and those thoughts are coming from the enemy, then the enemy will be controlling my life. But if the enemy puts thought in my mind, and I reject that thought, I refuse to receive that thought, then the enemy has no control over me. Another issue that many of the people struggle with, and that is, because I thought it, then I must be a bad person. And I try to use this illustration. I said, if we went to getting your car fixed. And once I got out on my side and you got on your side, the mechanic right next to the car we drove in next to said some words that were not appropriate. In fact, he was swearing. And all of a sudden, I disappeared. And you walked around the car, and you saw me kneeling on the ground. And you said, "Logan, what are you doing?" And I said, "I'm confessing. And I'm praying to God, and I'm confessing." And they said, "What are you confessing?" "Well, I'm confessing I heard that man swear." And I said, "That doesn't make sense." I said, "It doesn't make sense either for me to feel guilty about thoughts the enemy's putting into my mind. If I don't act on those thoughts, all I need to say is I give no consent to that." Now, another important issue here that I share with him on the first day, and that is, how do I know if a thought is from the enemy, or from God, or from me? And this is vital, because it's going, well, how do you know? And I say, first of all, are these thoughts you're struggling with, are they coming from God? And they go, "Oh, no, no way. I know it's not God." I said, "Well, how do you tell the difference between your thoughts and enemy thoughts?" And there's two ways. How do I know an intruding thought? And that is when I think things that I don't want to think. I don't want to think like that, and yet that thought comes into my mind, and it's there. The second is when I can't stop that thought. Because I can set my mind on things above. I can put my mind where I want it to be. But if the enemy's putting intruding thoughts in my mind, it just seems to be bombard my mind over and over and over with that thought. And that's a real key, that thought is of the enemy. And all a person has to say is, "I give no consent to that. And I just refuse to receive it. And I'm not going to feel guilty about a thought that's coming into my mind from an outside source." The other thing we try to accomplish on day one is to show the person that Satan was defeated at the cross. This is vitally important. First of all, they need to know that not every thought that's coming into their mind while you're working with them or during the week is necessarily from them, and it can come from the enemy. The second thing is the enemy was defeated at the cross of Christ. And we take them, as we walk through the scripture, we take them in the one passage that you need to go through is Colossians chapter 2, the three verses there that talk about the three things that were dealt with at the cross of Christ. The first thing we're told that was dealt with at the cross of Christ was the sin issue. When Jesus died on the cross, the sin issue was dealt with once and for all. The second issue was the fulfilling of all of the Old Testament for us in Christ. We're not under law anymore. It was totally fulfilled in Christ. The third is the disarming of principalities and powers, the public putting on public display, and triumphing over them in Christ. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he totally, completely defeated the enemy. And the weapons of Satan were taken away. The only weapon that Satan has to use against us today is a lie. Satan is a liar. He's a father of lies. And every single attack of the enemy will have a lie in it to a greater and lesser degree. People say, "Well, if Satan is defeated, then how come we see so much awful things going on? How come I'm struggling in my life, and I know that there's enemy involvement in my life? I know I'm under the influence of the enemy." Colossians chapter 1 answers that question, and that is, God has delivered us, in verse 13, God has delivered us from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. You and I, as believers, have been delivered from the power of darkness, but we've not been delivered from the presence of darkness. The Bible makes it very clear that Satan is a prince of the power of the air, and the whole world lies in the wicked one. And we're living on Satan's turf. And I've been around a while, as you can tell by looking at the video. And I can tell you things are getting worse and worse. Evil is getting worse in our nation. The availability of immoral materials, immoral television shows, and all these kinds of things are getting worse and worse. So the battle is getting harder and harder for young people, and I really feel for them, and I feel for my grandchildren, that they're growing up in a world that's much more corrupt than the world that I grew up in. And so Satan has this right. And then the last thing we do on day one is we go to Revelation chapter 12, and I have them read 7 through 11. And as we read along, the first thing we see, we get down to verse 9, and they read that, and I said, "What does it say Satan does?" And we see that Satan is a deceiver. And we bring out, do you realize that a deception is different than a lie? A deception is when my mind and emotions believe something that's not true. And so most of the people that come here for counseling are being terribly deceived. We live in a culture that if you feel something, it must be true. And so they have tremendous amount of struggles with their emotions. And if I feel I'm inferior, then I must be. Or if I feel this, it must be. So Satan is a deceiver. And it's not just a thought, but he also has access and plays with my emotion. The second thing it tells us in verse 10 is Satan is the accuser. And so we have an enemy. This Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 tells us that our focus is to be on the Lord Jesus Christ. Every attack of the enemy is to get my eyes off of Christ. John chapter 10, verse 10 tells us that Satan wants to steal, kill, and destroy. Every attack of anyone that you're going to counsel that's under demonic assault, the purpose is to rob that person of eternal significance. They get so wrapped up in their problems, they feel so messed up, they can't reach out to others. Many times they feel their situation is hopeless and that maybe ending it all would be a thing to do. And then Satan destroys relationships. And relationships begin to crumble. Marriages begin to fall. He comes between parents and their children and other people and so on. Those are the three purposes of the attack. And Satan does it through deceiving and then through accusing. Satan will put thoughts in a person's mind and then accuse them for thinking those thoughts. Often, so many lights come on the very first day as they begin to realize how much of their mind has been under the attack of the enemy. And then we come to the end of the first day, and that is verse 11. And it says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. And so what we have them do right here is we have them make a commitment. They can either speak it out to the enemy. If they feel uncomfortable with that, they can pray and make that commitment to God. I think I prefer that they speak it out to the enemy. And the commitment is something like this. Satan, I want you to know that I no longer want you or anything you do in my life, and that I want to be committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. Some commitment where they take a stand against the enemy and verbally take a stand with God. Or they could pray, Father, I want to be committed to you. I want your word to be the final authority in my life. And I don't want any of Satan's involvement in my life at all. I want to be free from any involvement in my life. That is the end of day one. At the end of day one, I give them Psalms 18 to read and ask God for a rhema, a special truth from that psalm that they could claim for the week. When they come back the following day, we start day two with them sharing that special verse that God gave them for that week. What's been amazing, in Psalms 18, no one ever picked this verse until one teenager picked it and shared this verse. And when he read this verse to me, he began to cry. Many teenagers pick this particular verse. And it's verse 19 of Psalms 18. He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. And that teenager, through his tears, the very first one that ever picked this, through his tears, he said, Mr. Logan, do you realize that God delights in me? And it just thrilled him to think that God delighted in him. Okay, day two. Now, day two on out, you can follow the book, and I'll tell you where to go. It's that very first day that is not in the book. It's scattered through the book, but not like we would do it. Day two, there are two important things that you want to cover with that person. The first is occult involvement. Now, we use a check sheet where they mark any kind of occult involvement they have. Remember, if you've read the book, there are four reasons people get in the cult: power, guidance, protection, and healing. Those are four reasons. And if they were involved in any occult involvement, We have them renounce that and then pray that God would take back all ground they gave through the enemy. That if it was power, that God, I don't want enemy power in my life. I only want the power of your Holy Spirit in my life. If it was guidance, Father, I don't want to be guided any longer by the predictions that I had or the Ouija board or anything else that they were using to guide them. I want to be guided by your word. Lord, I know you're the healer, and I've gone into some strange things for healing, and I renounce that, and I ask that you would take back that ground. And Lord, I'm not going to go into darkness for healing any longer or occultic New Age type healings. And Lord, you're my protector, and I'm no longer going to trust in amulets or charms or these kinds of things for protection. The second thing that we want you to do on the second day with this person is to deal in the area of bitterness. That is done very well in the chapter. All the scripture verses are listed for you. But let me share just some of the things that are there. Just today, the counselee that I was dealing with said to me, oh, I've gone to a Gottfried seminar. And I've read that thing on bitterness. I've read some books on forgiveness. And I don't have any bitterness in my life. Well, I have found that one of the common themes of someone struggling with enemy involvement is bitterness. And so I just wondered, was this person, he said, I even prayed before I came if there was, you know, anyone that I have resentments in my life towards. And he said, there is no one. I can't think of anyone I have resentments towards. And then as we were talking, this person resented their design. They resented the way that God made them. And I said, well, who is responsible for your design? And they said, God, Psalms 139, I'm fearfully, wonderfully made, and so on. And the person broke down and wept and said, I never wanted to acknowledge that I really am bitter for God for the way he made me. And they had to work through that issue of bitterness, ask God's forgiveness for resentments towards him, for the way that they were put together, and to thank God that they really were truly, fearfully, and wonderfully made. And they worked through that, and this person came to great freedom today. But bitterness is a major area, and the two areas that often a person doesn't think about forgiving is God and themselves. Many people have done tremendous things in their life and scarred their life very, very deeply, and they need to receive God's forgiveness. A teenager may say, God, I forgive you. I don't correct them. I know that God is smiling, and they know the person wants to do what's right. But for a mature person, they need to say, God, forgive me for my bitterness towards you. You know, I realize that I've had these resentments towards you. My resentments towards God was because he put me in the family he did. I just, it was hard for me to believe that God would do that, and I had to come to grips with that, and God has really helped me many years ago to ask this forgiveness because I can see now the advantage of what I went through in my childhood. So that is day two. At the end of day two, I will assign them a verse. And you say, a chapter to read and to come the next day. I cannot tell you what chapter to have them read because I base it on the problem. If they're having a lot of fears in their life, I try to get a psalm that deals with fears. I try to have them read a chapter and ask God for something special that seems to come out in their life that I really sense, because the psalms really deal with so many of the emotional spectrum in a person's life. And then the next day, and then the other assignment I have, and I asked them this, I said, are there people out there, if they were sitting in this office as we're praying and ask God to bring to mind people that have hurt you, would your name be on that list? I said, what do you mean? I said, are there people out there that you have hurt that are holding feelings towards you that aren't right? And I want you just tonight as you go to pray and ask God to bring to your mind people that you've hurt that you maybe need to go back to. And bring that list tomorrow, and we will go over that list. So on Wednesday, when they bring that list in, we go over that list to see, is it proper for them to go back to that person? Sometimes it would cause that person great difficulties. And also, what would they say to that person if they do go back to that individual? And so we work through the wording, and we also want to see, would it be proper to come back into that person's life and to set up a schedule where they would do that? Because the Apostle Paul said he had a conscience void of offense towards God and men. The scripture seems to indicate, because Hymenaeus and Alexander did not feel that a clear conscience was important, they were turned over to Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme. Then we also deal on day three, we deal with the issue of rebellion. Was there rebelliousness in their life? And to place themselves and be willing to place themselves back under the God-given authorities. That is dealt with in the book, and all the scripture is there that you need. But with a teenager, you may need to help them to, what are the God-given authorities in your life? Let's list them, and let's put them down, and let them begin to not just see that God says that all authorities are ordained by Him, and that those who resist the authority will receive to themselves damnation, but help them to identify who are the authority structures in their life, and possibly they need to make things right with that very authority structure that they've been resisting, the God-given position of their father or their mother or whatever. And so that is day three. If you try to skip the occultic involvement on day two and go into some of these other areas because the occultic involvement was very strong, you will wish you hadn't. Anyone who has been heavily involved, I'm not talking about a dabbler, but not anyone heavily involved in occult involvement, those are the people that are the absolute most difficult ones to deal with. Because when they've gone into Satan's territory and willingly and openly open themselves up to those powers, if you try to help that person, there will be all kinds of conflicts going on in their mind or even in their behavior that will not allow them to be able to track mentally with you. You must do the occultic thing first, and especially the more involvement there's been. Now, day four is a real turning day for that person. On day four is the day that we deal with the area of pride. That is usually the total turning point for a person that's here. And you have a whole chapter of that in the book. And go over that and really familiarize yourself with that material. Pride is what makes us most like the enemy. And people say, oh, that so opened my eyes to what the enemy was doing in my life. The last aspect that we deal with on Thursday, and this one is probably one of the most touchy issues and one I'd like to share that you don't get trapped, and that is taking back ground that was given to the enemy sexually. The person has dealt with pride, so it's a little bit easier to deal with the sexual issues in their life. What we have them do, and it's explained in the book very in detail, but we have them pray and ask God to show them where they first gave ground to the enemy. There are two ways that people basically are in bondage. One is emotional, the other is by doing. Men are more into doing that which is wrong, and women are more into feeling. But there are women who are in bondage sexually. But a great majority of the men that we see, this is a major part of their bondage. So we ask them to walk through. Now, what you have to be careful about, first of all, I'm talking about a fellow working with a fellow. When I work with a fellow, Ephesians 4:27 says, don't give detailed accounts of immorality. People say, but what if I say I committed adultery. I said, well, the Bible said that David committed adultery. The Bible said that the woman was taken to Jesus in the very adulterous act. That is naming what took place, but it doesn't describe what took place. So be very careful that you don't listen to descriptions of evil. It can cause you tremendous problems if you do. If a person, as they walk through their life, begin to share intimate details, stop them and say, it's not important that we know the details. All you need to do is to, as the Spirit of God is showing you, the different ways in which you gave ground. When I counsel a woman and we come to this part, I tell them I will leave the room while they go through. I don't even want to hear even the name for what they did. And I walk out of the room and I tell them to, when they get through going through their life and taking back all ground they've given to the enemy sexually, to open the door and I will come back in. That is vitally important. I was talking to a pastor recently on the phone who was dealing with a woman, and he said, you know, curiosity wanted me to get the details, but I kept thinking of Ephesians 4:27, and I said, you were very, very wise. It's far better for a woman to counsel a woman and a man to counsel a man, but there may be a situation in which it's impossible for that to take place, and if it is, then just walk out of the room. And this say, pray and ask God to take back all ground you've given to the enemy sexually. Now, this is where, for the first time, this is Thursday now, and we're all through, and this is the first time now, we actually come against and address the enemy. And so we, at this point, we tell the person, we have a prayer that they we give them to read, although they don't have to. I don't like using prepared prayers simply because a person can say, I prayed the prayer, but it's not prayers that set a person free. It's truth that sets them free. And most people that I deal with know how to pray. And a lot of them come from very conservative backgrounds, and to pray a written prayer is not something that those in the Bible movement and Bible churches and those from that background feel very comfortable in doing. And so they need to include in this prayer any kind of ancestral thing that may have passed on to them, any kind of a family spirit that's come on that family, and especially if they seem to have some type of occult abilities, that they would pray against a familiar spirit, that, you know, they command any spirits that came to them ancestrally, any spirits that passed on to them that would be a familiar spirit that came on to them, any kind of a curse that may have been put on the family, that God would cancel that out and break that curse, and they stand in the finished work of Christ on that. And then they command anything that is not of God in or around them to leave and to go where Jesus Christ sends them. I want them to do that. Then I follow that by my praying with them. I say, you have as much authority over the enemy as I do. All I'm going to do is to agree with you. Jesus said, if two agreed, how powerful the prayer could be. And I just want to agree with you in prayer. And I pray anything that's attacking their mind to leave and to go where Jesus sends it. Anything that has been focusing on their emotional life and just damaging them emotionally to leave them. Or anything that's been exercising a lot of pressure upon their chooser or their will to leave them. Anything that may be attacking them physically, or anything that may be attacking them spiritually. What do you mean spiritually? One of the most deceptive kinds of spirits to deal with are religious spirits. People that get into extreme strangeness in their walk with the Lord. Strange kinds of religious experience. Spending inordinate times in prayer and reading scripture when they need to be doing something else. Usually they come across very pseudo-spiritual, that they've achieved a plane higher than other people. They're very, very deceived. The enemy would love to deceive people in that area. Seeking experiences that would shortcut spirituality rather than obedience to the Word of God and walking in the light as in a day-by-day experience. We pray against that if we see that. If there's been specific things, if they've done a lot, been involved in perverted experience, I pray specifically against that. If there's tremendous fear, I pray specifically against that. I want to pray specific. So as you know and as the week they've shared, you want to pray specific against those things. Then I pray, Lord, if we have accomplished your will and purpose in this person's life, and if this person has achieved freedom from enemy involvement in their life, I pray that your Holy Spirit that bears witness with their spirit that they're your child, that your spirit would bear witness with their spirit right now by letting them sense within them a sense of special sense of your love, your joy, and overall your peace. I pray that the peace of God that passes all understanding would be something they would sense in their inner being. That the peace Jesus said, I give unto you, not as the world gives, that they would experience that. And the peace of God that rules, that it would rule in their heart. Then I pray, Lord, and as I'm praying now, I'm watching to see, is there a sense of peace in their countenance? And then I pray, Lord, but if we miss something, if there's something we didn't deal with thoroughly or something that somehow we just skipped over, Lord, I pray right now, if there's still enemy involvement in their life, that you would put a heaviness or a check in their spirit. And when that happens, often, immediately, that person senses it. And often with a teenager, I'll say, we'll pray and say, Lord, now, show us. You would bring to mind to this young person or to this person just what we need to deal with. And often with a young person, it's so amazing, it's their music. They say, it's my music. And I said, that's right, you didn't give your music to God, did you? And I said, would you be willing to yield that music to God and let God direct you and through your parents of what music would be right and proper for you to listen to? Or it may be an area of resentment or bitterness or whatever. Just basically kind of said, I'm immoral. And God said, wait a minute, you've been so immoral, you really haven't come to grips with how much you've grieved the Spirit of God through your immorality. And God wanted him to deal more in depth. And he said, well, listen, we happen to have a river by here. And I said, why don't you go down? It was the summertime. Why don't you go down and walk along the river and begin to deal with those relationships and confess them to God and get to the bottom of them and not just skim over them like you did. God wants you to really see how entrapped you were in your sexual bondage. And so they pray through, they deal with that issue, and then we pray again and say, Lord, if that was it, then give them peace in their heart. And then they say, you know, I have peace. And then we thank God for giving them peace. Their assignment that night is always the same one, is Psalms 91. I give them Psalms 18 on Monday and Psalms 91 on Thursday night and ask them to bring a rhema, or a truth from God's Word, the next day on Friday. And Friday, we again pray with them. If they came to freedom on Thursday, they'll be free on Friday. So we pray and say, we want you, again, Lord, to testify to their innermost being, that if they're free, that you will just continue to let them experience this, the peace of God that passes all understanding. But if not, put a check. And I don't think I've ever had anyone who had peace on Thursday not have peace on Friday. Then Friday is a special day because people are saying, how do I maintain a walk of freedom? And we want them to help them maintain a walk of freedom. There is a chapter on the book, and the chapter in the book is the chapter on the armor of God, and you need to go through the armor of God. The second aspect that they need to go through is they need to understand how, back again to 2 Corinthians, how that Satan can take charge of their thinking or put thoughts in their mind. Most everyone that comes has tremendous struggles with thinking. We've just recently come in contact with probably one of the finest workbooks that we have seen written on taking thoughts captive. This book is available through ICBC. And I want to talk about some other things that would be available that may help you or help your counselee. Here are some other materials that may help you with your counselees. Mark Bubeck, the founder of ICBC, has written 3 books, and 2 of them have been bestsellers for many years, The Adversary and Overcoming the Adversary, and then The Rise and Fall of Fallen Angels. The Dallas Tapes, Getting Free and Staying Free, are tapes designed to help in ministry, to help families. It's just an explanation of how to reclaim ground, and you may find those very helpful. There's another set of videos we have available, and it's called the Spiritual Warfare Conference. These tapes were done for 500 missionaries at Wycliffe Jungle Aviation and Radio Services. And the emphasis of those tapes is more on people working in animistic cultures and understanding something of animistic beliefs. So those tapes are very helpful to missionaries and people working with people outside of the American culture. The third video is really unique that's available, and it's called Perilous Times and Seducing Spirits. What makes this video very unique, it is a video of the American Indians sharing their experience with the spirit world. It is not easy for them to talk about this, and this tape is just extremely helpful in understanding where these people are coming from and the struggles they're having. It would help you to be able to pray more effectively for those coming to Christ from the background. Also, we are developing a work or study guide to go with the book Reclaiming Surrendered Ground. And you may be interested in that study guide. It really is detailed and will cause you to go through the book and to really think through a lot of these issues and make applications. ICBC stands ready to help you in any way that we can. And if we can be of help to you, please feel free in contacting us, and we can send you materials that we have, or answer letters, or call you back. When you call, as the girls take your telephone call, but we want to serve you.